Australia, not just luring our nurses and police officers across the ditch, now early childcare teachers are being targeted too. The state of Victoria is offering up to $50,000 in relocation fees. One New Zealand-based recruiter told Breakfast she's fielding hundreds of calls from ECE teachers wanting to make the move, describing it as a mass exodus. ECE teacher Ken Ah Honi moved to Victoria from Porirua just 3 weeks ago. He's got up very early on the other side of the Tasman to speak to us. Ken, thanks so much for your time this morning. What was the final straw that made you move?
So I've been a teacher for 10 years and graduated with my degree in teaching ECE. It was the cost of living. Like, I wasn't able to live independently, you know, on my own. So I had to move in back with my parents. It's just not something I wanted to do. Then an opportunity opened up, and it was through the Victorian incentive. So they were, you know, offering money, and yeah, I decided to take it.
Was the draw card the money?
Yeah, pretty much money and just some of the working conditions.
Yeah, so talk to me about those working conditions, Ken. Like, for our viewers, and lots of them will have kids who go to an early childhood centre, but they obviously don't stay there the whole day like you do. What is the job like, and what are the bits of it that make it so much more difficult that you feel it's not worth working here for and you'd rather be over there?
So in New Zealand, we have some great companies who are passionate about providing quality childcare. And I was lucky enough to end my teaching time in New Zealand in one of those companies. However, other centres that I have seen have been a real wake-up call to the things that are lacking with ECE teaching. And the conditions for change have been brought forward to the government so many times, and they're just continuously shut down. And this is creating the teacher shortages and why people are leaving.
Can you give us some specific examples? And we're going to talk to the minister next, so I just want to get an idea from you about what are the sorts of things that are, you know, they might be pay-related or pay-adjacent, but what are the other things like in a centre that you think, I've had enough of this, there's not enough support, or there's not enough staff, or what is it?
Yeah, exactly that, not enough staff. So teachers like us who are, I mean, there were times where I would be sick and I just, there wasn't enough staff to support us. So I'd be going in sick to work, and it wasn't ideal for my own well-being, and I needed to move on and do something else.
Well, and presumably not for spreading bugs around a childcare centre either, I wouldn't have thought. Kim, is there anything that would make you come back to New Zealand and take up ECE teaching again?
Make me come back? Maybe if we're seen as, like, we're valued. If we're more valued and seen as more important, our roles as educators, and we're not seen as, you know, like babysitters, then maybe, yeah. If we were funded better and well looked after, then maybe I would come back.
Would improvements to the pay parity scheme make a difference to you? Does the scheme need to be thrown out and start again? Does it need improvements? Is pay parity a focus for you in that?
Yeah, I feel like it was a focus. I just feel like I wasn't making enough to be living like independently there. And yeah.
Are you happy now, Ken?
Yes.
Good.
Everything's better.
Well, I'm sorry we've lost you, but I'm glad it's worked out for you at least. That's Ken Honi joining us from Kerr Lewis in Victoria. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
All right, the union representing early childhood teachers, NZEI, says the industry is in crisis and teachers are overworked, undervalued and underpaid. The union says there's a huge workforce shortage, with fewer people choosing it as a career, others turning their back on the sector or heading overseas. This message from the union to the government.
You know, their plans for what they're doing to our funding system and what they're doing to what they're saying about pay parity, for us, it's scary, and it means that we're going to have even less teachers than what we do now, and we already don't have enough. I want the funding system to be reviewed so that all teachers are provided with pay parity, and it's not sort of an opt-in process, and also so that creates quality for all children in New Zealand, not dependent on what is close to your where you live. Every child should be provided with quality childcare in New Zealand. Not it shouldn't be an opt-in process.
Well, listening in to that and our earlier interview with Ken is Associate Education Minister David Seymour. He joins us now. Now, you're here because you're responsible for ECEs. You've just heard the thoughts of a teacher and of, obviously, the union. What are you going to do about it? They're obviously not happy, and there's some big money talking over the other side of the ditch.
Yeah, well, look, I mean, he seems like a nice guy, and it's a shame to lose him from a New Zealand centre. I think, first of all, you've got to recognise that this is not just ECE. Last year, New Zealand had a record outflow of New Zealand citizens. A net 47,000 Kiwis left the country, more than any other year. And that's happening in just about every sector, largely because wages and productivity are lower in New Zealand than countries people are going to.
Sure.
That's what this government's inherited. In the case of early childhood education, people are leaving there too. However, over the last year, we've also seen a 3% increase in the number of ECE teachers. We've gone from about 32,600 to about 33,700 in the country. And that's similar to the wider story in New Zealand, that while a lot of people are leaving, the number of people coming into the country is actually greater. Now, we can have a debate about whether that's good or bad.
Yeah, are you saying we're just buying in childhood teachers, like Australia's buying in ours, and we're just buying in ours from somewhere else?
Well, I think people, let's just start with people, make choices, and there are people choosing to leave New Zealand. I think that's very bad. There are people around the world choosing to come here. In the short term, it means that the number of people available to teach in early childhood education has actually gone up about 3%. But your question is, what are you going to do about it?
Yes, well, you don't think that we maybe don't need to, would be the implication if the numbers are increasing. You think the situation is not dire or is not as bad as it's being made out to be?
No, I think it's important that, you know, a conversation like this starts with facts, and I've just given you the really basic ones. But nonetheless, the idea that there is low morale and that people are very frustrated in the sector is true. In the time that I've been involved, and that includes before I was the minister, visiting centres and talking to people that operate them and parents that send their kids there, I'd say that there's a few things going on. One is money. You know, we put about $2.7 billion of taxpayer money into ECE each year, and we'll increase that in this budget.
I know, all we get is some of the most expensive childcare in the entire world,
yeah,
right?
So there is you know, significant taxpayer money going in there, and it will increase at this budget. The second thing is the enormous inflexibility around the funding formula. So you've just heard the NZEI say that they want pay parity right across the sector. But let's just be clear what that means. It means an inflexible scale of union negotiated payments for every single worker in the sector, and where the people operating the centres end up is they get a certain amount of money per hour per kid from the parents and from the government, and then they have to pay these rates, and it sometimes doesn't make a lot of sense.
But you haven't got pay parity at the moment, and you've got a problem. So why not do pay parity and maybe don't have a problem?
Well, because it already, where it applies, in order to have pay parity, in order to get extra funding, you have to apply it. So, you know, where it applies, it actually is inflexible and it creates very strange incentives. For example, you'll see centres where somebody who's not that experienced, who's coming from overseas, one of those people we were talking about earlier, actually ends up getting paid more than somebody who is at a lower pay grade but from New Zealand and is actually more useful in the centre. So,
is that an issue to you? Because when we started off this conversation, you talked about the numbers going up, and that is largely reliant on migration. That's not New Zealand graduates, and yet we are seeing New Zealand graduates go overseas. These are Kiwis leaving our country and being replaced by foreign workers coming in to fill the gap.
And this is my point.
Is that actually a problem?
Well, here's the point. What pay parity means, if you think it's a problem, then pay parity means that you have to pay somebody who is a New Zealander, recently graduated, less than someone who is from overseas, maybe actually less New Zealand experience, and less useful to the kids in that centre at that time. So if you want to put this inflexible model right across the system, I just tell you that's one of the consequences of what the union are asking for.
You could alter the pay parity scheme, though. I mean, the union can ask for one thing and you can apply something else. At the end of the day, the union is actually also just asking for more money. People like Ken are saying, we need to be paid more. The salary difference, I think it's $50,000 starting wage in New Zealand. It's $80,000 in Australia. I mean, that it's $30,000.
Yeah, and unfortunately, that's not too far off the difference in the average wage between the two countries. I mean, we got to wake up and face that reality.
That we're always going to have lower wages than them anyway.
No, that's a pessimistic prognostication, Anna.
No, I'm just saying you just said we had to face reality.
The reality is that the statistics are that today. The reality is we've had successive governments that have not focused on productivity, have not focused on getting more homes built, which is part of that guy's problem and why he left. He had to live with his parents, you notice. And as a result, you know, it's attractive for people to leave New Zealand. We need to fix productivity. We need to fix over-regulation. We need to fix housing. If we don't do those things as a government, I suspect that people will lose confidence in us. And if we don't do those things as a country, I suspect that more and more young people will lose confidence in us.
Finally, everything you've just said, valid points, none of it was what they're asking for, which is more money. Will you give the sector more money?
Well, if you recall the start of the interview just 3 minutes ago, I said that there will be an increase in this year's budget, so it's actually yes. But the other
for them to stop saying they need more money?
I think that would be the first time in the history of any budgeting process. But here's the other thing we're going to do. We're also going to reduce the crazy amounts of rules that take up people's time and make it harder to work and run in a centre.
We will run that conversation another day.
Well, here's an example you love.
Well, I appreciate it. There is a whole argument around regulation, but we are talking on pay today. So, David Seymour,
the regulation that makes it harder to run is one of the major frustrations.
Sure, but that is an entirely different argument that we have not. I haven't prepped for it, and you weren't prepped for it either.
I'm totally prepped for it, Anna. It's a major example of the problems we're having.
I promise we will discuss it another day. David Seymour, thank you so much for coming in.
Thank you.